You have your Bibles open to John chapter 10 there, and we're going to be in verses 11 to 21. I'd like to read it this morning. We've been in a series that I do. Pastor John's been preaching through spiritual gifts, and he'll be getting back to, I think, Matthew coming here in the rest of the month. And so when I preach every 5 weeks, I have my own series that I do, and I've been doing one on the I Am's of the Gospel of John. We've looked at I Am the Bread of Life, I Am the Light of the World, and I Am the Door, and today we'll be looking at I Am the Good Shepherd. So here's what we read, verse 11. I'm the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He was a hireling and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep. Beholds the wolf coming, leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he's a hireling and he is not concerned about the sheep. But I'm the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Now I have other sheep which are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall become one flock with one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. Now no one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father. There arose a division again among the Jews because of these words. Many of them were saying, he has a demon and is insane. Why do you listen to him? And others were saying, well, these are not the sayings of one with demon possessed. A demon cannot open the eyes of the blind, can he? Now let's bow for prayer as we come to God's word. Lord, we come to your word because we anticipate and know that you can speak to us. And as you speak to us, it's by the illuminating work of your spirit. So we ask your spirit to do that work today, that's able to come alongside us, take the word of God and make it practical for us, but also use your word that it may encourage us or comfort us or even correct us. And that may be responsive to what you want to teach us today from your word to our hearts and to our minds. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Yesterday, Mel and I had the privilege to go to a memorial service for a good friend of ours. Bill was 94 years old, been a godly man that impacted our life, impacted other people's lives, and we heard testimonies of other people who he impacted. And Bill has been in hospice for probably the last 3 months. He had broken his leg or injury and all and just hadn't recovered well. And I remember we'd go and visit with Bill and Arlene and just chat with them. But it was also interesting as we were doing that to realize there's questions that start coming up at the end of life. There's things when people are waiting to pass away that you start asking yourself and curious about. Relationships you want restored, things you'd like to say. I came across that University of Pennsylvania this past month, at their commencement speaker, who was a Pulitzer Prize winner author, he's also an oncologist. His name, if I can get it right, is Siddhartha Mukherjee. And as he was speaking, he identified in his work as an oncologist, working with people who are probably passing away from cancer. He said there's probably four phrases that he hears that people wrestle with at that time. Here are the four phrases. People wrestle with the question is, I want to tell you that I love you. Or, I want to tell you that I forgive you. Or, we may even ask this, would you tell me that you love me? Or would you give me your forgiveness? Those are powerful questions, the ones we want answered. We come to this passage in John, we're just a few chapters away from the triumphal entry of Jesus and his death. Chapter 11, he's going to raise Lazarus from the dead. Chapter 12 is a triumphal entry. You almost come to this chapter, and it's almost you hear Jesus saying, there's something I want you to know before I die. There's something I want you to understand about me before I die. There's something important for you to hear me tell you before I die, and that you understand this before I die. As he does that, he's going to walk through here and give some description of what he's talking about. He starts off talking about the part of his life. What you need to understand is he's one who is sacrificing. He's going to be sacrificing as a good shepherd. Here's what he says. He starts off and he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. Now, it's interesting he's called the good shepherd. There's two other passages where he's talked about as a shepherd. And what I find interesting on this one, too, is all the other ones we've looked at have not had this adjective before it. He's the bread of life. He's been the door. He's been the light of the world. But this is not just, he doesn't say he's just the shepherd. He wants to understand that he is the good shepherd. Here's what I mean. In 1 Peter 5:4, here's how he describes himself there. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. He's talking in that section about leaders in the church of elders. Peter calls himself a fellow elder, gives instruction to the elders, who in their command is to shepherd the flock. But Jesus wants them to understand, who is the chief shepherd? It's not Peter. It's no religious leader. It's no local church pastor. No, the chief shepherd, the chief leader, the chief elder, the chief shepherd of the church is Jesus Christ. There's another passage. In Hebrews 13, he says this. We read this. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. He's not the chief shepherd or the good shepherd. In this passage, he comes and he's called the great shepherd. What's the great shepherd do? He not just lays down his life for the sheep. The great shepherd comes along, he actually equips, prepares his sheep on how to live in this world. And he wants you to understand that's what the chief shepherd does. Or the great shepherd. Now we come to our passage, and he wants us to understand he's going to talk about the good shepherd. As he talks about the good shepherd, we sort of wrestle with this word, because what's so good about good? I mean, we use good so easily. You know, we have good food. And again, we have good view. We listen to good music, but we know it's not awesome. It's just good. But that's not true in the scriptures. The word good is very valuable. In fact, it identifies something very worthy, something very valuable, something that sits at high honor. So though our word good sort of puts it down here, the biblical word kalos puts it way up here. In fact, when the word good is used in the New Testament, it identifies something far greater than just something that is good. In fact, Jesus goes so far to say that the only one that is good is God. Let me read for you. This is Mark chapter 10, verses 17 and 18. And as he was setting out on his journey, as Jesus, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked Jesus, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone." For Jesus to call himself the good shepherd, he's not just saying he's good. I think he's not just saying that he's noble and good. I think he's speaking in the sense of just like God. Who's God? Only God is good, and therefore Jesus is just like God. There's another passage that's used. This is more interesting. Romans 5, the word good is used here. And it's walking through how Christ will die on the cross for our sins, and God demonstrates his love for us. But he says this, "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly." So Christ is going to die for the ungodly. Then he adds this, "For one will scarcely or rarely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die." It's like, well, that's interesting. For righteous versus good. Here's the idea. If you were going to sacrifice your life for another person, you rarely do it for the person over there that is righteously living, and you don't know them at all. Oh, you know they're righteous. You know they live well and all. You look at them and say, well, rarely will somebody just die for somebody they don't know. But a good person is not just righteous. A good person is something who has done something for you, benefited you in some way. And because of that, you may not. You probably won't. But you might, for a good person, you may sacrifice your life. I want you to understand, this word good is not down here low. It's above our awesome word. It is way up here to the point that to call himself good is saying he's God. He is the good shepherd. He is God in the flesh. And what's he going to do? He's going to sacrifice his life. What does a good shepherd do? He lays down his life for the sheep. Understand that, my friends. Jesus Christ is saying he's going to lay down his life for you. Don't think of the person next to you. Don't think of somebody else. You need to personalize this. You need to grasp this. You need to let this sink into your head, down into your heart, that Jesus Christ is saying he lays down his life for you, for who you are, for all that you've done. He lays down his life for you. He sacrifices his life for you. And he loves you to that degree. Now, he really wants us to understand this, how much he sacrifices and what he really did. And he goes on now and he gives us a description, not of a good shepherd, but of a hireling. He says, here's two kinds of people with the sheep. We've got the sheep here. We got the good shepherd. He's going to lead the sheep. But we got the guy we've hired to take care of the sheep while the shepherd's not around. So the good shepherd, or the hireling, comes in here. He starts describing them because he wants to get the contrast. Understand the difference between a good shepherd and the hireling. So here's how he describes the hireling, starting in verse 12. He who is a hireling and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, beholds a wolf coming, leaves the sheep, flees the sheep, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. And he flees because he is a hireling and he is not concerned about the sheep. Catch the process here. What you guys, the hireling here, he's hanging out with the sheep, keeping an eye on everything. Makes it very clear he does not own the sheep. These are not his, they're somebody else's, so he's just taking care of them for somebody else. All of a sudden, it says he beholds a wolf coming. So from a distance, here comes the wolf. Now we have to understand, in Israel at that time, they not only had wolves, they had panthers, jackals, leopards, bears, and hyenas. They were coming out in the countryside. Just imagine one of those coming towards you. And the hireling's there, and all of a sudden he sees one of these, and what's he do? He's not concerned about the sheep. He's concerned about who? I do not want to die. So what does he do? It's just, I love this story. It's like, when he hears the wolf coming, he leaves the sheep. He flees. You can just see him whoosh, running off in the distance. And the wolves then what? They come in, they start snatching the sheep. The sheep, they don't snatch. What happens? They just scatter and they start running. And now you've got scattered sheep. You've got snatched sheep. You've got a fleeing hireling. And how's he concluded here? And why does he flee? Because he's a hireling. And he adds this, he is not concerned about the sheep. Oh, what a great story here we have here. Jesus lays down his life for the sheep. The hireling, he finds himself running from the sheep. How important is it to understand this? Here's what Jesus says in John 15. There's no greater love than this, that a person lay down his life for his friends. So later on in John, he's going to tell you the power of laying your life down for somebody. You know what it means? That you're loved. For someone to lay down their life for you, for the good shepherd to lay down our life for me, for the good shepherd to lay down his life for you, means that Jesus Christ loves you because he's laid down his life for you. And you only do that for your friends. And to think of yourself as a friend of Jesus. That's what he wants us to understand. He's not the hireling. He's the good shepherd. He is God who chooses to lay down his life for each and every one of us here to demonstrate that he loves us. That is sacrifice. But he goes beyond sacrifice. He says, the good shepherd just isn't sacrificing. You know the intimacy of the good shepherd. He talks about knowing us. Look what he says next. How's this come about? Verse 14 and 15. He says it again. I am the good shepherd. And now catch these words. I know my own. My own know me. Even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and what? I lay down my life for the sheep. He wants us to know that he knows us. This is intimacy. Let's understand the intimacy that Christ is saying he has with us. This good shepherd just has a knowledge of us. He's saying that he knows us intimately. And not only that, he tells us we can know him intimately. What does that really look like? Well, I'm not sure how I understand this passage on this part, but he equates and grounds our relationship with Christ to the very relationship God the Father has with God the Son in heaven. Now, I'm not sure how they commune. I'm not sure how they interact on everything, but he wants to understand, look, it is that intimate. As God the Father and God the Son know each other, that relationship is just as intimate as our relationship with Jesus Christ. He knows us just as much as he knows God the Father. He is just as intimate with us as he is with God the Father, and he's just as intimate with us, and we also get to know him in that way. You know, and knowing that, it's realizing what we often think about ourselves. Somehow, I think, we have this idea that he really doesn't know us completely, so we need to reflect on our own being of who we are and what we've done, because he might forget that. Now, we've all come to Christ at different places in our life at different age, from little kids to adults. But no matter when we even came to Christ, there's things we've done, even as believers in Christ, that we wish we hadn't done. There are many things we regret, words we wish we hadn't said, things we wish we hadn't done, and unfortunately, they never leave our memory of what they are. And the way we live life at times is we keep remembering things that we've done. We go through our life and we somehow have this ongoing thought of ourselves. And we may think of ourselves, we're that liar who lied at that one time. We could be a deceiver. We could be a thief, a robber. We could be somebody who just gets angry. We've been hurtful of people. Damaged relationships, adulterers, haters, addicts. We may find ourselves being swindlers. All these sins that we collect and know of ourselves may not share with anybody else in this room. Nobody may never even know what we have done, what we thought, what's in our heart, and deeds we've actually done. But we know them, and we're aware of them. And oftentimes they weigh us down. And this guilt that we have in our hearts of who we are and who we think we are, it weighs us down. And things we may not share with any other person. And yet it tells us that Jesus knows each of us intimately. And he knows those very things. And he loves us. And he lays down his life for us. But you know what's more important than that? Or just as important, I would say, not more important. It's interesting when Paul writes all his letters to the churches. And the church I always find the most interesting is the Corinthian church. Now, I would not have wanted to be in that church. But the benefit we have of that poor, functioning, dysfunctional, unusual church is we've got 29 chapters of the Bible because they were such a rough-going church and struggled with so many things. And we get 29 chapters in the Bible because of them. So here we got this church which struggles with so many things. They write letters to Paul, and Paul has to write them back. Okay, here's how you deal with this. Here's how you deal with this. They've just got so many problems they're working through. So here's the church, and I'll say, of all the New Testament churches, it seems one of the Probably not one. I wouldn't want to pastor it. Pastor John probably would do very well doing that one and bringing them forward, not because he's bad, but because he knows how to deal with those things. I'm just saying, look, this is not a church. I don't think you find yourself, oh, that's where I want to go. It's very interesting when Paul writes this. Now, not all the churches get the same address. But what I'm trying to point out to you is what he calls the Corinthians when he addresses them. He writes all his letters the same way. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the church of Corinth, Philippi, Ephesus. Pick out the name you want. And he always greets them all the same way. He calls them to the saints. You know what saints means? Holy ones. I want you to think about this. When Paul attaches a name to you of what you are as a follower of Christ, he calls you a saint. He calls you a saint. You do not have to be one who, for the Roman Catholic Church, they have saints. How do you become a saint in the Catholic Church? You got to do some miracle at some point. And not just one, at least two. And then I could be Saint Michael. Or you could be a church. I mean, have you drive around town? Have you ever noticed the names of churches? Saint Thomas Church, Saint Mark Church, Saint Luke Church, Saint, all these saint churches. So you could be a church, but that's not what Paul's talking about. You could be an apostle, because oftentimes we talk about Saint Matthew, Saint Mark, Saint, well, not Mark, but not Luke, but St. John, and go to the apostle. That's not it either. He calls every believer in this dysfunctional Corinthian church, struggling with life. He even identifies all the things they were before they came to Christ. And he identifies, and such were some of you, but you've been sanctified and been saved. And all changes. We're not the people we used to be. So we don't live like we used to live. And when God looks down at each and every one of you, he calls you a saint. He says you're holy. That's why I can tell you, and Peter writes and said, you need to be holy just like God is holy. Why? Brethren, we are saints. We're not evil ones. We're not liars, we're not deceivers, we're not haters. We are saints. And I want you to understand, when Jesus Christ looks at you and knows you intimately, he is not recalling all our baggage in the past and collecting all that and saying, oh, here's what you really are. He doesn't do that. He's forgiven all that in the past, raises us up, looks at us and calls us holy ones. He calls us saints. Because he knows us, but he forgives us, and he loves us, because he lays down his life for us. Oh, he goes on. He's not just one who does those things. He comes along, and he also wants us to understand that he's unifying. Look what else he says here, starting at verse 16. And I have other sheep, which are not of the fold, and I must bring them also, and they shall hear my voice, and they shall become one flock with one another, or with one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. So in verse 18, or 16 and 17, he's saying this is what's going to happen. He says he's got a flock here already that he's taken care of. But there's some other sheep that he has to go get. And when he gets those sheep, they'll hear his voice, they'll come following with him, and you know what? They will join the other sheep he already has, and they become one flock. Now, the flock he already has are the Jewish people. The flock he's talking about going to get are Gentiles. And I think for most of us in here, probably most of us in here, if not all of us in here, but I don't know all your stories, so there's probably a few Jewish people here, but the rest of us who are not are that other flock that he went to find, that he brought in to be with the Jewish folks, to make us unified as one flock. He wants us to know that Christ has the capacity to bring people from different backgrounds into one gathering and make them unified in one. And as this unifying factor. Now, for the Jewish people, there were only two kinds of people, Jews and Gentiles. Now, as I moved here to Chicago, I found it interesting of the communities you find downtown in Chicago. You can still find Chinatown, Greek town, Polish communities, Russian communities. Go on and on and on. You will find the different communities that they have. And one of the marks of those communities oftentimes is they speak the same language. And what we talk about is being ethnic. They're different ethnicities. Now, it's interesting when you get to the Great Commission, and Jesus Christ making those final words to his apostles, he says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Now, when you hear nations, you may think countries. You know, take out your map, and you have countries. But that's not the word that's used here. The word for nations in Greek is ethnos, of which we get our word what? Ethnic, which is speaking of languages. And so when we start talking about unifying the church, in Paul's day, Jesus' day, Jew and Gentile, that was it. But in our day, it goes broader than that, doesn't it? Of us thinking of all the ethnicities that we have. And what Christ is talking about, that he's going to bring them all together and unify them. And he starts dealing with that issue that we wrestle with, however little bit it may be in our hearts, or how big it may be. It's that whole thing of racism, of how we can look at other people who look different, sound different, we don't even understand, and somehow draw conclusions about them that are wrong. That somehow we can find ourselves finding it real easy to embrace people like ourselves, and more difficult to embrace people who are different. Whether it deals with the color of their skin, whether it deals with how they speak, the foods they eat, the holidays they celebrate, we recognize that they're different. And what Jesus Christ wants us to understand, that he's telling the Jewish people that he came to make one body, one church, and he unifies us together. That when we gather as believers, we recognize that we've reached all ethnicities, all nations. Do you realize what worship in heaven is going to be like? All people from all nations. So what language are we going to speak in heaven, Pastor John? All of a sudden, somehow we all gather for worship in heaven, all different nations, all different ethnicities as one. But Jesus Christ is saying, you know, it doesn't start in heaven. It starts right here on earth. And our hearts, folks, can we go out these doors and look in our community and identify the ethnicities here that we need to reach for Christ? And not just reach them. The idea that we can welcome people from all different ethnicities into our fellowship, that we are one. Why? Because the good shepherd is unifying his flock. And we are part of that unifying. Well, he wants us to understand that he unifies. He also wants us to understand not only that he's also commanding. I wrestled with this word, but it comes out of the end of the verses here, starting in verse 17. He says this, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life, and that I may take it again. No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down. I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father. The commandment comes out of this idea of commanding. Jesus Christ wants us to understand as a good shepherd, he has authority. How much authority does he have? What does it extend to? What sounds pretty simple to say he has the authority to lay down his life. Voluntarily, he does that. But he goes beyond that. He said he has the authority, after he is dead, sacrificed on the cross for our sins, that he can take his life up again and live again. That's how much authority he has. That's how much he can command to do. That's how much he's able to do as the good shepherd. Notice how he says this. He says, this is why the Father loves him. The Father loves him, why? Because he lays down his life that may take it up again. Why? He loves him because his son, the good shepherd, is being obedient in all things. The good shepherd understands he has to die on the cross. He has to be raised again. The Father loves him because he's going to be obedient to do all that he's called to do. When we get to the Garden of Gethsemane, we find Christ praying in the garden, if your will, can you take this cup? He's there wrestling with the whole idea of the sacrifice of his life, to lay it down and to raise it up. And he brings it before the Father. And he's telling the Father, I will be obedient to the end, to lay down my life, to see it raised up again. But I understand in doing that, I have the authority, I've got the power, I've got the initiative, I've got the command to lay it down. And I've got the commanding of my life to raise it up. And no matter who you think killed me, you need to understand, I'm the one who determined by my authority that I would die on that cross. And that is what I did out of my authority. He is commanding his life. He's commanding what he's doing with his authority, with his reigning, with his power of who he is. And he wants to see that the good shepherd comes along and he sacrifices. As he's sacrificing, he's going to be one who's not only sacrificing for us, he's going to be the one who's also coming along and he is going to be unifying for us. He's not only going to unify us together, he's also going to know us intimately. And he's not only going to do that, he wants us that he's commanding his whole life of all that's going to take place here in the end, in the next few chapters, all that was planned by him and known by him, and it will be accomplished by him. Now, you would think, hearing this wonderful good news about Jesus Christ, everybody would be flocking and say, this is the greatest news I've ever heard. Well, that's not what happens. Here's what happens when you hear who Christ is, and this is where we find out he's actually dividing. I want you to think about it. All the good news about Christ, everything we know about him, as believers in Christ, we follow him. I think at times we are surprised that there's this division between believers and unbelievers, that somehow they don't follow, we don't get it. How could they not if they understand all that is here? Christ describes what happens here. He gets done, and all of a sudden we find his life is dividing as well. And this is why people don't follow Christ. Here's what he says. There arose a division again among the Jews because of these words. And many of them were saying, he has a demon and is insane. Why do you listen to him? Others were saying, well, wait a second. These are not the sayings of one who's demon-possessed. Why? Because a demon can't open the eyes. That's how this all started in chapter 9. Open the eyes of a blind person that they can see. So some are demons. So it can't be a demon. What's going to happen here? But he says there's a division that takes place. And I think the division takes place over three reasons. One is because, as we've gone through here, there are some who understand what he's claiming is he is God. That is his deity. Saying that he's a good shepherd, he's claimed, I'm God. And we say, wait a second, you cannot be God. That's blasphemy. That's no different if Jesus were to say, I am, and just stop right there. They know exactly what that means. That's the name of God in the Old Testament. To say you're the God of the Old Testament or Yahweh, that's blasphemy. But he's claiming here that he is God. And his deity is one reason it divides people. Do they really believe that Jesus Christ is God? But there's a second one here, and that is the idea of unifying things. The Jewish people were God's chosen people. For them to contemplate that these Romans be somehow brought in together with them into one unified flock, these Gentiles who have done all these horrible things to them, persecuted them, killed them, held things against us. All these things they've watched and done. How could those be brought together in one? And because of that unifying factor, they cannot believe that this can be the good shepherd to shepherd them as folks. But there's a third one, I think. And that's understanding just the nature of grace. How Jesus Christ can love and forgive people. And that's his whole point here. What did Jesus want his sheep to know before he died? He wanted them to know that he loves them and he forgives them. Now, we think grace is one everybody would jump on and think it's the easiest thing to accept. Oh, I just accept grace. Oh, grace is the most wonderful thing that could ever happen. But we really resist grace. We really don't like grace. Now, I've shared this before, but when I was teaching at Moody, I always start off, I'd have a course that I'd never taught before. And for that reason, I realized the students had to suffer through this course, doing things that they didn't want to do, and I made it more difficult than I had to do. But at the end of the semester, I always did the same thing every semester for a new course. On the final exam, I gave them one instruction. I said to them, at the top of the page, write the word grace. And I will increase your grade one full grade. You have a B, I'll give you an A. Got a C, I'll give you a B. Have an F, you'll pass the course. All you have to do is write the word grace, G-R-A-C, at the top of the page. Don't do anything else. Don't add anything else to it. Just write the word grace. So I'd collect the books or exams, and I'd start looking at them. And here I had grace written with all these flowers around it. I had grace written with other things around it. I could not believe most of them added something to grace. And you know what? They didn't get the extra grade because they were unable and unwilling just to write grace. Now, I did this one other time in a class, and the way the exam was written up, there are only 10 questions. And I told the class, for the last five, there's a blank. In that blank, write the word G for number 6, R for number 7, A for number 8, C for number 9, and E for number 10. Write the word grace. Answer the first five. I'll give you correct answers, just write grace. Now, I had a student in the class who had a PhD from Texas A&M. And as I knew John, was one who he wrestled with a little pride and arrogance at times. And he decided he wanted to prove that he could get those all right. And so John, instead of writing grace, chose to answer the questions. And John got them all wrong. And John failed the test of one that he was confident he would pass, all because he was unwilling to accept grace. Grace is hard to accept. We think it's simple. It's not. Grace requires us to humble ourselves, requires ourselves to accept what God has done, requires us not to add anything to it, to know when we trust in Christ, that's it. He doesn't care if I went to church. You remember the pins you used to get for Sunday school attendance? None of that counts. All that counts is that Christ laid down his life for you. That he knows you. That he's unifying you. That he's accepting you. That he's one that's commanding you. That he loves you and forgives you and invites you to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. And that's grace. And I'm inviting you today, if you do not know Christ, it's the first time you've heard the gospel this way, to understand that Christ loves you and has forgiven you, that you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. He laid down his life for you. He brought it up again with the resurrection. He paid for the penalty of your sins. and invite you to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. But my brothers and sisters, I think many of us weigh on our own hearts and minds. We create our own guilt and stress by thinking about who we are in our past. And we allow Satan, who's called the accuser of the brethren, to bring charges against us on a daily basis that we are not qualified, we're unworthy, we should not be allowed into the presence of God nor accepted by Jesus Christ. And it weighs on us, and it weighs on us, and we need to turn around and embrace the Good Shepherd, who says he loves you, he forgives you. And you know what, my friends? He knows you. And he's not surprised by anything you have done, nor does he hold it over you to get it done, because he's forgiven you for what we've done. And that is his grace, and is wanting us to know that he's the Good Shepherd, and that he loves you, and he forgives you, and invites you to embrace him, to be the Good Shepherd who knows you, who sacrificed for you, who unifies you, is the one who also commands you to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Let's close in prayer. Lord, we give you thanks for the Good Shepherd. How good it is that Jesus has laid down his life for us. How good to know that he tells us that he loves us, that he forgives us, and that we can embrace him, one, in that personal faith in Christ to begin that walk with him, but even as his followers, Lord, that we can once again embrace him to be assured of that forgiveness, because he knows everything about us. And let us all cultivate an ongoing, loving relationship with the Good Shepherd. In his name we pray. Amen.